With the coronavirus pandemic, COVID-19, ravaging mankind at the present moment, let us look at what might turn out to be the most virulent topic of the century, the structure of virus. Now, microbes, if we talk of microbes, the three basic characters, first they are unicellular. We can say most are unicellular. They are not visible to the naked eye and they can only be seen under a microscope. Microorganisms, four types can basically be recognized: fungi, protozoa, bacteria, and virus. Fungi and protozoa, they are called eukaryotes. Eukaryotes, as we know, are organisms which have a nuclear membrane, a well-defined nucleus. There are other differences between prokaryotes and eukaryotes, which we are going to take up on a later date. Bacteria, they are prokaryotes. They do not have a well-defined nucleus. Virus, they are acellular. That is, they do not possess the typical characteristics of a cell. Now, viruses, they are basically ultra-microscopic. Ultra-microscopic means that they are too small to be seen by an ordinary optical microscope, a normal microscope that we use in a laboratory. They are obligate intracellular parasites. Intracellular, they live inside the cell. Obligate, they cannot live without the host. They are not facultative, they are obligate. That replicates solely by exploiting living cells. That is, they go inside the cell, exploit the cell, and by this way they carry on their life based on the information in the viral genome. The study of viruses is known as virology. According to Brown, now viruses, they are stretches of either DNA or RNA. That is, they may be either DNA or RNA. They are encapsulated in a protein and or a membrane. Fine. That is, initially there will be a protein coat around them. Then some viruses may have a membrane around them also that infect a cellular host. They go inside the cell, merged with its cytoplasm or nucleoplasm, and then uses the host's cellular machinery for replication. It cannot replicate on its own. It has to use the machinery of the cell it invades in order to replicate, that is, to make copies of its own. Interestingly, the host cell accepts the nucleic acid and proceeds to produce the components of the new virus. In accordance with the genetic information it contains, the genetic information is provided by the virus, and in accordance to that, the host cell proceeds to produce the components of the new viruses. Viruses are hence sometimes called as vagabond genes. What does vagabond mean? Vagabond means an organism that does not have a permanent settled home, that moves on from one place to another. And that is what happens with viruses also. They invade a cell, destroy the cell, and then move on to another cell. Viruses differ from other microorganisms in a number of basic characteristics. What are they? They have no cellular structure. That is why we said they are acellular. Sorry. Consist only of proteins and nucleic acid. So the basic components of virus are proteins and nucleic acid. Nucleic acids are inside, and then we have the capsid, and then we have the envelope. In some viruses, we have the envelope where the proteins are basically there. They have no metabolic systems of their own, and they exploit host's cellular metabolism by delivering their own genetic information into the cell. So these are the two basic differences between viruses and other microorganisms. Now, viruses show the properties of self-replication and mutation. Self-replication basically means that it produces an identical copy of itself. Mutation, definitely we know, are changes in the genes. Viruses, they are not capable of self-repair, and they do not have an energy transduction system. Now we need to understand what is energy transduction system. Now, transduction, it is basically conveyance of energy. That is, energy is transferred, it is conveyed. Energy is conveyed from one electron to another. The electron which gives the energy is known as the donor electron, and one which receives is known as the receptor electron. And at the same time, when this happens, there's a change in the class of energy. Let me repeat it. So energy transduction, transduction basically means that the energy is being conveyed from one electron, which is a donor, to another electron, which is a receptor. And at the same time, what is happening is that there's a change in the class of energy. Energy transduction in eukaryotes basically takes place in the mitochondrial membranes. And this is because of the transmembrane difference of electrochemical potential. There's a difference in electrochemical potential between the mitochondrial membranes, and as a result of which, the energy transduction system operates. Now, most of us are non-photosynthetic. That is, we cannot make our own food. We cannot produce our own energy. We take in the food. The food is digested. The proteins are digested, the carbohydrates and the lipids, the proteins are digested into amino acids, carbohydrates into carbohydrates are digested into glucose, etc., lipids into fatty acids and glycerol, and these give the energy which feed the electrons in the respiratory chain. The digested food provides the energy which feeds the electron in the respiratory chain, which is present on the mitochondrial membranes. And the net result is that ATP is produced. Now, interestingly, this is the basic essential characteristics of all organisms. So viruses are not capable of doing this. So they can simply be described as macromolecular aggregates. Macromolecular, they have many molecules, inanimate particles. Since they are not capable of energy transduction, we cannot call them as animate particles, that by themselves are unable to reproduce. They use a host cell to reproduce. They cannot carry on their own metabolism or carry on any other activities associated with life. For this reason, viruses are not considered to be organisms and are not described as being alive. Please have a look at the slide again. Well, now about the size of the viruses. Say the smallest of the virus that we have is parvovirus. It is around 25 nanometer. What is a nanometer? A nanometer is 10 to the power minus 9 meter. That is a nanometer. The largest virus that we know is the pox, are the pox viruses, which are around 300 nanometers. In comparison, bacteria, they are 1000 nanometers or more. Viruses, as we have already said, that they are ultra microscopic. They cannot be viewed by a normal light microscope, so they could not be visualized until the electron microscope was invented in the 1940s. And along with that, many other technologies had to come before the structure of the virus was resolved. So cryogenic EM uses methods by which samples are taken down to cryogenic temperatures. Cryogenic temperatures means ranging from minus 150 degree centigrade to around minus 273 degree centigrade. So temperatures are brought down, then electron microscope operates along with computer image processing, and with the help of this, smaller structures around 1 to 2 nanometer can be resolved. X-ray crystallography. Fine. We are talking of cryogenic crystals. Fine. They are put to X-ray crystallography method, and it is the only method by which atomic level resolutions can be made. What it means to say is that we try to determine the atomic and molecular structure of a crystal. So the first atomic level structure of a virus, which was solved, that was in 1978, it was Tomato-Bucci stunt virus. Now, outside a living cell, the virus which exists, it exists as a particle which is known as a virion. Now, typical RNA virus, the structure is shown. We have the viral genome inside. Around it is a shell which is known as capsid. Envelope may be present sometimes, and proteins are incorporated into the envelope. Viral genome. It may either be DNA or RNA. If it is DNA, it is known as DNA virus. If it is RNA, it is known as RNA virus. We have one exception. Cytomegalovirus, CMV, contains both a DNA code and an mRNA. Now, nucleic acid, again, the same thing. That is, we have DNA viruses and we have RNA viruses. Now, DNA viruses, they are usually double-stranded, that they got two strands, and they may be linear, straight, or they may be circular. RNA viruses, they are usually single-stranded, except in reoviruses, which are double-stranded. Now, what do viral genomes do? They typically encode the viral code proteins. Fine. If you refer to the earlier diagram, we had the capsid, along the capsid we had the envelope, which is the code. So the code proteins are encoded by the viral genomes, as well as the proteins, they co-opt the host enzymes needed to replicate the genome. Fine. When they need to replicate, it is the viral genomes which provide the information. Single-stranded RNA viruses, they are of two types: plus strand viruses and minus strand viruses. This is interesting. RNA of the genome has the same polarity as the viral messenger RNA. RNA of the genome of the host. Minus strand viruses, RNA of the genome has the opposite polarity as the viral mRNA. So, what happens in plus strand viruses, the RNA of the genome of the host can function directly as a messenger RNA or mRNA to produce the proteins which are required. RNA of the genome cannot be translated into proteins unless it has first been transcribed into a complementary strand, right? So the RNA of the genome of the minus strand viruses cannot be translated directly or cannot function as a messenger mRNA directly. It has to be translated into proteins. Sorry, it cannot be translated into proteins unless it has first been transcribed into a complementary strand. Very sorry for the mess up. Now, capsid. Capsid is the shell that encloses the nucleic acid of the virus. Capsid plus nucleic acid, that is known as nucleocapsid. Now, the subunits of the capsids, they are known as capsomers, and they are constant for each species. The subunits, they are known as capsomers, and they are constant for each species. Now, capsid can have three types of symmetry. It can have cubic symmetry, it can have helical or complex. Functions, what are the functions of the capsid? Definitely, they protect the nucleic acid, and they help for attachment to the host. Envelope. Animal viruses. Nucleocapsid is contained inside a lipoprotein membrane. That is, outside the nucleocapsid, there is a lipoprotein membrane, and they are known as enveloped viruses. Now, viral proteins, which are integrated into the membrane, they appear like spikes or papillomers. Now, papillomers are what? They are non-homologous proteins, heterologous proteins, which can function together. In the same manner, these are papillomers. So, viral proteins which are integrated into the membrane, they appear like spikes or papillomers. If the envelope is absent, the viruses are known as naked viruses. Other components, this I am going to read out directly. Enzymes, example, neuraminidase required for invasion and release of mixoviruses. These are some special cases. Heme agglutinin, some viruses, mixoviruses and paramyxoviruses, are capable of agglutinating human and animal erythrocytes. That is, they bring them together. These viruses bear a certain surface protein, heme agglutinin, heme agglutinin means for blood. Heme comes from blood, agglutinin means to bring them together. In the envelope, that enables them to do this. Heme agglutinin plays a decisive role in absorption and penetration of the virus into the host cell. The virus is absorbed and then it penetrates into the host cell. Now, classification of viruses. The first thing out here is virus classification is artificial, that it does not reflect virus evolution. Now, first classification that we have is based on genome. So, the genome can either be DNA or RNA. The virus can be single-stranded or double-stranded. It may have plus polarity or it may have minus polarity. Based on capsid symmetry. The capsid, the initial covering around the nucleic acid, the capsid, it can either be cubic or it can be helical or we may have complex symmetry. Now, DNA viruses, three types basically. Double-stranded DNA viruses, there are two strands. One is a plus strand, other is a minus strand. Plus and a minus strand. Minus strand, minus DNA strand, directly transcribed into viral mRNA. The minus strand directly transcribes into a viral mRNA. Example, herpes family of viruses and adenoviruses. Single-stranded DNA viruses. Once inside the host cell, Interestingly, the single-stranded DNA converts into a double-stranded DNA. And then the same thing happens as with the double-stranded DNA viruses. That is, the minus strand is transcribed into a viral mRNA. Example, adeno-associated virus and parvovirus B19. Reverse transcribing DNA viruses. Now, basically, what is reverse transcription? Reverse transcription basically is a process of synthesizing DNA using RNA as a template and reverse transcriptase as a catalyst. Synthesizing DNA from RNA using reverse transcriptase as a catalyst. So replication involves the generation of an intermediate mRNA molecule from which DNA is reverse transcribed. Example, hepatitis B. RNA viruses basically of four types. Double-stranded RNA viruses. The plus strand functions as a viral mRNA. In DNA viruses, it was the minus strand which was functioning. Here it is the plus strand which is functioning as a viral mRNA. Example, rotavirus. Positive sense, single-stranded RNA viruses. Positive sense, viral RNA is identical to viral mRNA and immediately be translated into viral proteins. The dangerous coronavirus, it is a positive sense, single-strand RNA virus. Negative sense, single-strand RNA virus. Negative sense viral RNA is a mirror image of the mRNA and must be converted into a positive sense RNA before viral proteins can be translated. Very simple. Example, influenza, measles, Ebola virus. Again, simply same here, we have reverse transcribing RNA virus, also known as retroviruses. These are positive sense, single strand RNA viruses that produce a DNA intermediate with a unique enzyme called reverse transcriptase. So whensoever from an RNA, a DNA is being produced using the enzyme reverse transcriptase, that is known as reverse transcription. Example, HIV virus. So what are the types of RNA viruses? We have double-stranded RNA viruses. The plus strand directly functions as a viral mRNA. Positive sense single strand RNA viruses is identical to the positive sense identical to the viral mRNA. So can directly be translated, negative sense and reverse transcription. Now based on capsid symmetry, first we have is cubic symmetry. We have capsid, we have DNA, we have glycoprotein. Now, viruses are with rotational symmetry are icosahedrons. Now, what is icosahedron? To understand that, we have to go back to basic high school geometry. First, let us see what is a polygon. How do we define a polygon? So what is a polygon? A polygon is a plane two-dimensional shape. Plane shape, two-dimensional shape with straight lines. Say a triangle is a polygon. A rectangle is a polygon. Fine. A circle is not a polygon. So the definition says that it has to have straight lines. Two-dimensional shape having straight lines, that is known as a polygon. Now, when many polygons combine, they make a polyhedron. So, if you look at the Rubik's cube, fine, it is a regular polyhedron. Regular means, say, the size of the square is the same. Fine, the size of the sides is the same. So, it is a regular polyhedron with six sides. Now, if we have a polyhedron with 20 equilateral triangular faces, 20 equilateral triangles, then it is known as icosahedron. I'm repeating it again. A polygon is simply a two-dimensional figure. When many polygons are combined, it becomes a three-dimensional figure, which is a polyhedron, fine, just like a Rubik's cube, where many squares are combined. And a polyhedron with 20 equilateral triangular faces, that is known as icosahedron. Fine. The number of capsomers, again the same thing, the number of capsomers, which are the units of capsid per virion, varies from 32 to 252 and depends upon the numbers of capsomers making up one side of the equilateral triangle. Fine. So how many capsomers are there on each of the equilateral triangles? That will determine the total number of capsomers per viron, and it may range from 32 to 252. Helical symmetry, very simple. When one axis of a capsid is longer than the other, one axis is longer than the other, then it is known as helical symmetry. This is also known as the filament or rod type virus. The nucleic acid and capsid protein are closely associated in the ribonucleoprotein, in which the protein is tightly arrayed around the nucleic acid strand. The protein coils around the nucleic acid strand, example the tobacco mosaic virus. Complex symmetry. This is the case of bacteriophages. Bacteriophages means basically what? Bacteria eating viruses. That is, the viruses which infect the bacteria, they are known as bacteriophages. Example is smallpox virus, T bacteriophage. They have again a icosahedral head containing the DNA. This is the icosahedral head containing the DNA. And a tube-like tail through which the DNA is injected into the cell. It has a tail beneath it. Fine. And the DNA is injected into the cell through this tube, which attaches to the cell. So these are a few references for further reading, and you can post your feedback at the mail ID given below. Thank you.